JP Doyle said, let's play. And Duncan Weir does exactly that. Puts it high into this glorious evening sky. Well claimed by Italy.
Drop back, use it.
But straight away, not a great start. Gieson knocks on from that. And seconds on the watch. What a terrible start, Carlo Del Sottofava. You're looking for a nice, solid possession, and Italy haven't got it.
They did so well to take that kickoff with Quinten Geldenhuis fielding that ball. But it's just a bit of inaccuracy at the back of that maul with Davide Jazzon actually just losing it. But what a great position for Scotland to actually attack.
So important to get the scrummaging right from the very first minute. The referee wants to stamp his authority on this. Sam Hidalgo-Klein to put the ball in for Scotland. And it's gone straight to ground on the far side. And we'll do it again.
Both scrums sitting very, very low to the ground there. Everybody has their studs planted into the ground and contributing something. All they need to do now is just consolidate that pressure, keep this ball up and apply it in the right direction.
You can see already that the pitch is starting to cut up where they're scrummaging. And they've come a couple of yards to the left, and it might just give Scotland a bit more of a blind side should they want it. All the backs are lined up open side. There's pressure coming on. It goes to ground, and the first penalty goes to Scotland.
Loose head outside.
Two minutes played. Good pressure.
That's the right call there from JP Doyle. All the action was actually happening on Matias Agüero's side, deemed to have gone down from the Italian loose head. But what fantastic cohesion and low height from that Scottish pack. They really have improved that facet of their game, and I think Italy will have their work cut out for them this evening.
So Duncan Weir is going to get the first shot at goal into the number 10 shirt this evening after Greg Tonks played there against Ireland last weekend. His 19th cap for Scotland. He's got 36 international points already. It's a good strike. He's turned away straight away. The flags go up. Scotland, from the opening kickoff, Italy make the mistake. And Scotland punish them. They win the penalty. And Scotland are already into the lead. Deep kick by Tommaso Allan. Well claimed by Scotland.
Ball's there. Play the ball.
Hidalgo Klein clears left footed safely into touch. And we've only played 4 minutes, Carlo, but you'd say Scotland have started this the better and maybe the side that look like they've got had 80 minutes last week.
They do. They just seem to have a bit more control with everything that they are doing. They're getting the exit strategy right with Sam Hidalgo-Klein there. The joy of actually having a left-footed kicker straight into touch and puts the opposition on the back foot.
Well, Gieson gets his throw right after knocking on earlier, and here come the Italians through the forward power. Taken on by Zani. It's a bit loose and Minto's going to get hit behind the gain line. Good clean possession though.
Use it.
Palazzani decides power game for a bit more. Now we're going to see the attacking options. Tommaso Allan. Scotland defensively will be quite happy with this. They're putting Italy across the pitch rather than letting them go forward. And the defence is holding up as we reach phase number 7. Here though comes the opportunity.
Benvenuti with the half break. Now can they make it pay? Mazzi stopped instantly. The blindside option again as Aguero takes it up to the edge of the 22. Vanessa takes it on again. It's going to have to go wider this time, or is it? No, it's not. Bernabo goes through. The opportunity. Is it there? Van Dijk. Oh, there's a knock on. And it's, can Scotland counter-attack quickly under the their own post? The opportunity was there. It's going to be cleared by Hidalgo Klein up over halfway. Is that going to stay? No, it won't. Well, great pressure, but just the final moment.
Maintaining position for so many multiple phases, and it's just that inaccuracy between Jatson and Zani, who's the ball carrier, is not nominated, and the ball's just gone slightly in front of but excellent clearance kick there from Sam Hidalgo Klein.
The pass was almost halfway between them, wasn't it?
It was. It just in that no man's land between who was the nominated runner and who wasn't. But excellent ball retention displayed there by Italy.
Great work by Sarto. And the line-out has been lost, and here's the opportunity. Hardy takes it on. The New Zealander, first appearance for Scotland this evening. Weir, can he spot a half-gap? Yes, he can. Vernon puts it out to Tonks. He knocks it on, though. And just as we're talking about a lack of precision at one end, there we go at the other.
Good ball.
We spoke about mastering your set piece beginning of the game. And here we see Scotland just same thing, just those teething errors, just lacking that cohesion from potentially new players on the field. Just slight inaccuracy, nothing to that. That's actually just a personal error. But that actually came from a lost Italian lineout. The jumper went up. The ball actually didn't come in. Seems to have been just a bit of confusion with the communication.
Well, from a scrum in a similar position on the pitch, Scotland won the first penalty of the game. This time, though, the put-in will go to the home side.
Crouch! Bye! Set!
That scrum was always going down and straight away.
You changed your shape and you dropped him onto the ground. Okay? Get your feet underneath his then, second rows.
JP Doyle very clear in his assessment there.
Very precise as well. Actually mentioning what the Scottish loose said Gordon Reid was actually doing there. Just dropping his weight below his pelvis. So he's actually, his head and his shoulders aren't able to support his body weight. The scrum goes down, inaccurate, results in a penalty against him.
Well, Gordon Reid's not happy with the assessment, but JP Doyle's not going to change his mind now, I'll tell him that much.
He was on the right side as well to make that call, so happened right in front of him.
An opportunity for Italy. Go with a quick one at the front of the line-out. Can they execute and secure the ball?
Use it!
Yes, they can, but it's slow. Is this the opportunity? Fantastic defence by Scotland. Two men in on the tackle, driving the man back. Any momentum suddenly disappears. Unless, as they come down the outside, Minto. Now they're looking for work. Wingers coming off the wing as Von Dieti comes in. Sarto's out on this near side. Oh, that was almost an interception. Now he's going to get the opportunity to run it, Sarto. Mazzi in midfield. Sarto's following the play across, picks up the ball. Scotland again, though, will be quite pleased with this defence. They're managing to push Italy across the field of play. And again, close quarter stuff from Italy. Very little change out of the Scottish defence. Mazzi joins the line. That looks like it could be a telling break. But again, ninth phase. Then the ball goes loose. And not only is it picked up by Scotland, it's a penalty as well. 2 minutes worth of pressure, 2 minutes worth of ball and territory, and it comes to nothing.
excellent defense there from Scotland. That man, John Hardy, wearing the number 7 jersey for Scotland, has put in some massive hits. Yeah, we see Leonardo Sarto tackled again by John Hardy. He's putting his body on the line. He's making his presence felt. What Italy need to do now is just move away from something being very lateral. They need to be more direct with their attack. They need to speed up their ruck ball. That's going to allow them to actually move into those open spaces.
Well, Hardy's a contentious decision. Coming in from New Zealand, first appearance, but he's done everything his coach would have wanted from him so far.
He's put in 3 massive hits already, and I think that adrenaline rush from being selected in the starting lineup first up could be his motivation to carry on going in this game.
Stuart McAnally's also on debut. He gets his line out to Richie Grace, just a bit short, but good enough for Scotland to be able to make good yardage, and they're coming forward. Ash takes the ball on inside the 22 then. Someone's going to have to play scrum half. And it's Mike Cusack, another man starting for the first time. Made his debut against Ireland last week. And now Strokosz, the skipper, takes it on. And again, penalty. Italy not releasing on the ground. More Scottish pressure leads to another potential shot at goal.
To see Alistair Strokosz there taking that ball in. JP Doyle deeming the tackler to not be releasing. And in this case, it looked like Tommy Benvenuti coming away with the ball in that ruck. But JP Doyle not interpreting that to be a clear release in the tackle. And penalty resulting for Scotland.
Make sure that latcher fires through. Yeah, fires through, stays up, works hard. Okay. If he's on the ball, different, but he's not on the ball.
So where's going to get his second shot at the sticks, this time from the other side of the field. Fabulous start for Scotland. Clean strike once again. No doubt as it sails through. And Scotland have a 6-point lead. Two out of two for Duncan Weir. Again, the deep kickoff. Ash, the Scotland number 8, will take. He's found his support. And Hidalgo Klein should be able to clear this away. It will stay in field, though. Oh, fabulous tackle. Great timing. Fabulous timing on the initial tackle, but then the follow-up. Rory Hughes it was.
Excellent tackle here from Rory Hughes, coming in nice and low on a big man. It's the only place you can really take somebody that's heavier than you. Penalty, though, gone Italy's way for deemed an infringement at the ruck. Just see the hands going in there. There's a ruck formed. He needs to only use his feet or ruck over that ball and get beyond to make a counter-ruck effective.
Well, Italy win the penalty, and they're going to have the shot at goal. Gonzalo Garcia is the man who's going to have the crack at this one. And this is a long way out.
Gonzalo Garcia normally is the one that takes the long-range penalties. He's got a massive boot on him. Sometimes just lacks slight precision, though, in the kicking. But he's the one that normally takes the long-range penalties.
You get a great angle there of what he is looking at. Italy need to get something on the board to show for the first 14 minutes. It's on the way, and it's off the upright. Hidalgo Klein claims the ball, spins away from his tackle and fires the kick away as well, and safely into touch. Great work by the scrum half to be alive to the situation. And not only that, clear it up over halfway.
It is. It's his left boot that's actually getting Scotland out of trouble and keeping them in this Italian half. His box hits are excellent. They're finding touch. They're keeping the Scottish pack moving forward.
Shortened line out this time. As Gierzon goes to the tail. Good clean ball. It's moving, but it's moving sideways and it's been brought down. Advantage Italy. And it's Jim Hamilton who is a judge to have pulled it down. So it's going to be a penalty. Bang on the halfway line.
To see Tommy Allen trying to thread that ball through a very difficult position, but Gonzalo Garcia's right boot, what a gun. Just apps so close, just hitting that upright. And would have been just reward for his effort. But just a clever use of the tactic there. Italians actually moving out of the 15-meter line to win that line-out and setting up a maul, having Samuele Bonissa at the half-back position. Once the ball leaves the 15-meter line, the line-out is over. But I think just getting a bit of confidence to winning a ball from two inaccurate line-outs before.
So Garcia gets his second attempt. Straighter this one.
2 yards. 2 yards. 2 yards. Please, thank you.
He asks for the Scottish man in front of him to just retreat as he lines it up. Good contact. Good distance, good accuracy. Italy on the board. And Gonzalo Garcia is into double figures in international rugby points.
It's very important now that Italy recover this ball off the kickoff and actually reassert the pressure back onto the Scottish team. They need to maintain possession for a number of phases.
Duncan Weir once again will go to the right-hand side and goes deep. Better exit strategy from the Italians that side. Although the kick maybe didn't go as far as they would have been hoping, but it's at least a good distance outside the 22.
It's well recovered, it's well cleared, it keeps the forwards moving in the right direction, and it still puts Scotland, though, 40 metres out in a very, very promising position.
They've cut the line out. They've got Strokos bang in the middle of the field between the two centres. And bearing in mind one of the centres, Richie Vernon, is a former back rower himself. There's some power in there. The first part's won well. Now they start on the move. Hughes, the right winger, looking for work. Strokos gets his hands on it, drives hard and low. The ball is there, but unfortunately, Vanessa came too early.
Engaging the nine, he does not have the ball.
And that is going to be a penalty right in front of the post, and that's another pretty straightforward one in terms of giving a penalty and the shot at goal that comes from it.
Scotland very direct here in their attack, using one of their main ball carriers in Alistair Strokos. But just look at Samuele Bonissa on the right-hand side of your screen here. It's unnecessary. You don't need to do it. All the players are on their feet already because you have done the first job of slowing that Scottish ball down. It's not necessary. Stay out.
So the third opportunity for Duncan Weir. Two out of two so far. It's another clean strike. It sails between and Scotland re-establish their six-point lead. Three from three for Duncan Weir. He has all 9 points for Scotland.
I think the scoreline rightly reflects the control that Scotland have on this game. They're very clear in everything that they're doing. They're very decisive.
Halfway through the first half, and Scotland have certainly had more of the controls. Ball's there.
Use it.
Hidalgo Klein's taking all the responsibility himself so far. I'm sure Vern Cotter's delighted to see that from a young nine. 22-year-old, and he's willing to take the responsibility on his own shoulders. He's not going to fire out any bad ball in bad position.
He is, and he's actually making them play that extra phase infield just to open up that angle to make his box tick that much easier. He's clearing the ball well, but not only that, there's two chasers ready to stop that quick line-out.
Another throw to the tail, and another throw hasn't gone the way that Italy would want it. Scotland have knocked it on, though. So although they think there's going to be a half-break for Matt Scott, he's not going to get the opportunity, and it will be an Italian put into the scrummage.
Second rows. I understand it's difficult with the ground, but we got to get it right, okay? Just that thing. Boys, second rows, get your feet right, okay? I know it's difficult. Okay, come this way, yeah. Come this way.
You get the feeling JP Doyle's starting to get frustrated. A couple more maybe that go down, and he might be starting to think penalties.
Well, he's very clear in what he wants the two packs to accomplish this evening. His communication is very precise, he's really close to the scrum, and he's being really specific in what he's asking for, which just makes the reaction for the players that much easier.
Unfortunately, though, we're going to need another reset.
Get on the outside. Get on the outside.
That's a man who's definitely starting to get frustrated now. The tone of the voice has changed somewhat there, hasn't it?
Yes, he's meaning he actually asks Matias Alguero there to get on the outside, which just allows him to get that long blind, the long bind, which just adds that stability to the scrum. It just helps his balance if he is long bound.
No more warnings. I think that's the most telling word so far. The clock continues to tick, and I don't think we've had one completed scrum yet. That looks far more stable at this stage anyway. Neither eight giving an inch. Italy just getting the nudge on and going forward. And now they get the penalty that comes from it. Excellent drive. They finally got it together and they get the reward.
Fantastic reaction there from the Italian pack. The whole shape of the scrum looked different. It was stable, it's very low, very cohesive, and just the power that comes on, Scotland can't cope with that. They have to lose their bind and concede the penalty.
Well, this time there's going to be a change of kicker. Tommaso Allan is going to take this one. Garcia's had the first two attempts, and this time Allan will get the go. It's almost as if Italy needed the first 20 minutes to get it into their lungs, to get the breath going, to get the legs going, to get the adrenaline flowing. And if that scrum's anything to go by, it looks like they might have found it now. The youngster from Perpignan swings that right boot to great effect. And it's back to a three-point ball game. Italy 6, Scotland 9, all with the boot so far. You get the feeling this match is now starting to find its feet and find its legs. Another deep kick off by Weir. Vanessa will take it once again. The Scottish tacklers go high. They do stop him. Good work by Hardy, the open side for Scotland, stops his man. Italy have it and will be able to clear it. Touched in flight though. So that will be an Italian ball. Touched by the Scotland player, trying to charge it down, the hooker Stuart McInally. So a good territorial game for Italy, Colin.
Good territorial game, but also a good example of the different exit strategy used by the two teams. Italy don't have a left foot kicker off the base of the scrum, so they have to pass the ball 10 metres back to make that gain, where Scotland just box kick it off the base of the scrum with the left foot kicker of Sam McGoldrick time.
Taken cleanly. This time they go towards the air. Tonks underneath it for Scotland. Good clean take. There were options down the blind side. Hidalgo Klein waved them away and then kicks it down the blind side, high rather than far, and Andrea Mazzi knocks on. Now, Scotland got the opportunity with a fullback out of the play. Weir takes it up over halfway, runs into traffic. Lovely hands to Hardy. Well taken by Ash. The pass just took a little bit of momentum out of his run. Richie Gray, can he get those long legs moving? Well, not in open play this time. Strokosh again, good clean ball. The Italians aren't really been able to slow it down, and that will be a concern as Scotland continue to move forward. Hidalgo Klein with the right boot this time, goes for the corner and finds it again. Two or three good phases of play. Kick on to the corner, good pressure.
Just see Mazzi there just having, taking his eye off the ball, actually coming off his shoulder. But look at the control from Sam Hidalgo Klein. He's managing this game by his kicking. He's keeping his pack going forward. He's picking off Italy into the right areas of the field.
Line out 5 metres out. Are Italy brave enough to go over the top? This stage it would be a big call. No, they're not. They've lost it anyway. And here comes Scotland. Right down the guts of the Italian defence. Here comes Scott. 5 metres out. Quick ball. Hidalgo Klein thought he saw a gap. It wasn't there. The ball is, though. 3 players to the left. Oh, and Scotland had the opportunity, had the pressure, but the man arriving, Mike Cusack, got his angle wrong, and the opportunity disappears.
Good turnover there from Scotland, resulting in that stolen lineout. But just the same way attack from them, and it's Mike Cusack who's actually deemed to cleaning Quinton Geldenhuis, using his head.
It's easy to say when a line-out doesn't work that it's the throw that's wrong. As a former second row, what are you seeing? Is it a timing issue? Is it a throwing issue? Or is it just a combination of everything?
I think in these three line-outs that they have lost, it's a combination of all three. The timing's off on the one. The communication was off on the other. And in this case, the jumper was just not as quick as Richie Gray. He got in front of the man, stole the ball very cleanly and with relative ease as well. So they need to move away from those tall jumpers. You've got Jim Hamilton, Richie Gray. They need to try and pick off some of the less, more agile jumpers in the line-out and just stay away from them because they are massive threats. And if you throw in that area, they will steal the ball.
Bit of a concern then. So if it was one problem, at least you could address it. When it's more than one, it's not as simple.
On the five, no ten, on the five. 5 and 15.
Pause in play, but we can get back going. Tommaso Allen clears to touch. shortened line out for the Italians once again. The pressure starting to build on Gison. 21st cap, only his third start. That one's clean. Scotland appealed that it wasn't straight, but we play on. Big numbers back the way they came if they want to use them. The overlap. And here comes Italy. Mazzi through the hands. Now there's an opportunity. Oh, wonderful bit of defending by Scotland. Just did enough. But Italy are in possession to strike. Tommaso Allan takes it into the 22. Hardy's making himself all sorts of nuisance, as is Richie Gray. Legally, though, says the referee. Power play by Italy. Heldenhuis takes it forward. Now the momentum goes, they're going to have to build it again. Good work by Aguero.
Use it! Ball available! Ball available!
Again, it's all short stuff at the moment. Until. Great defence by Scotland again. They held firm, waited for the mistake, and there it came. Weir will clear it. And Scotland defuse another situation.
Very frustrating from an Italian point of view. Performance there from Mazzi. And it's Venditti, but look at Rory Hughes with the ankle tap here. It's a big man just getting him down right on the touchline. And it's Zani taking this ball into contact. Scotland over it. It's a turnover ball. What happens? What needs to happen from that line break from Venditti down the touchline? The ball needs to travel through 10's hands. It can't go back to a short, tight, slow attack using the forwards. It's a line break move. It needs to stretch the defence further by getting quick ball to the backs.
Adam Ash has just had some running repairs. We've got water carriers all over the field. It's a lovely evening to play. Just warm enough if you're a spectator. Possibly a bit too warm if you're a player, as you can tell from the sweat. But there are no excuses this evening. Perfect night for it. Clean in the middle of the line out. Scotland on the verge of being penalised, and are penalised. And now here comes Benissa. Opportunity goes through, not held. Well played, Balazani. Oh, and another ball coughed up. They made 50 metres in a matter of seconds, but just as they approach the 22, the opportunity goes a-begging once again, and Scotland will clear. Weir hacks it downfield. Mazzi decides to hoist, and that's gone up rather than far. Well, the catches are judged to have gone backwards, so we play on. Nigel Owens, the touch judge to this side, said that was okay. And Scotland are over halfway. But it's a maul. They don't get it to ground. And so it's going to be an Italian scrum.
Excellent break here from Samuele Venisa, and Palazzani on his right shoulder. He's explosive, he's quick, he's fast, making his way into the space. And it's just a slight imprecision here from Greg Tonks knocking that ball on. But Matt Scott ready there to peel and take the crumbs.
Again, another pause in play. This time for Matias Aguero. Players push it to the limit, don't they? Referees know that as well. That's why he's saying that with a smile on his face.
I think scrum offs in particular tend to push the letter of the law a lot further than most and still be cheeky about it at the same time. But a great break there from Palazzani. I'd just like to see Italy hold the ball a bit more. Just build a few more phases, more than actually just four phases, and then either pass the ball up or concede a penalty.
Jack Brunel, I imagine, will be happy with a lot of what he's seen, but there's just that, it's the key word we keep using, precision all the time, isn't it?
It's the imprecision that just makes you lack fluidity and lack building momentum and just gaining that confidence in attack.
We're not going to get that scrum completed either. It's such a difficult thing. 8 against 8. Not wanting to give an inch, not wanting to give a quarter. And just the smallest moment, the smallest trigger. That's all it takes. A fraction too high, a fraction too low. Well, it goes in. And once again, Italy have just about got a nudge on there. The ball's available to play, so even though the scrum goes down, they will play, and in fact they win the penalty. The penalty against Cusack, his feet going from underneath him, and bang on halfway, Italy win another scrum penalty.
Italy are taking great confidence from asserting their dominance up front here, and you just see Mike Cusack, he's under pressure, Aguero's got him, it actually looked like Aguero actually slipped his bind there, but it happened on JP Doyle's side. And deemed to be under more pressure. Italy are looking to gain ascendancy up front. It's their strong point. The line-out isn't functioning as it should, and keeping this ball tight and within the forwards' grasp is, I think, the best way forward in this game. Anything they do look to expand, they lack a bit of imprecision. So they need to go into the half now, building a bit of confidence from asserting their dominance up front.
5.5 minutes of the first half to play. They will get another opportunity to practice the line-out. Full line-out. To the tail. And they move too early. The player comes in too early. And all that opportunity, the number 8, who's in the scrum half position, comes in to do the lifting. But as you hear JP Doyle very clearly say, before the ball... And you can't do that. Scotland elect through Duncan Weir to hoist it into the night sky. Well taken. Sarto. Takes it in towards the middle of the park. Vanessa brings it back on the blind side and gets met by a dark blue wall. That again, that ball popping out dangerously for Italy. And McAnally thinks he's spotted an opportunity to get in there. Boots a ball again into the sky. Tonks underneath it. Met as he comes down. And the ball is there for Hidalgo Klein. Richie Gray. And his forwards will take it on. It's outside of the 22. Onto your second row. They're really having to work hard and dig in to get that ball clear. Hidalgo Klein takes the responsibilities on. Tomasi on halfway, another fabulous tackle. Sean Lamont timing that one absolutely perfectly. He was fine, but the next man in came in from an offside position, and that's why Italy win the penalty. And JP Doyle is definitely getting frustrated. Hidalgo Klein claiming that the ball, I think, from that last ruck was being interfered with. And JP Doyle said, well, it was your own player who was causing the problem.
You just see numerous players there off their feet at that ruck. And as the Scottish player comes through on the mall, he's deemed to be coming offsides at that ruck. And JP Doyle is getting Morley's calls absolutely spot on this evening.
Well, well, well. This is a referee who is getting frustrated. He was in a very cheery disposition a couple of hours ago. I think it's starting to wear off. Good line-out this time from Italy. Now, can they get the drive on? Scotland get the counter move.
But Italy have rolled it round the side, and here they come. Vanessa, the number eight. Can they get it before the Scots realign? Good power. Zani takes it on. Vanessa will have another go. 2 yards. Hard yards as well. Towards the midfield. Now, good opportunity, left and right. They stay with the forwards though. Close quarters stuff. Ball's loose. And it's going to come back. And Heldenkrees sets up the opportunity for Vanessa. Continuity, can they get it? There's a Scots hand on it, sensibly released it. Italy 5 metres out. Big hit on Minto as he tries to come forward. Fern Cotter wanted the intensity up from Scotland this week from the defeat to Ireland. He's certainly getting it in the defensive sense. Gierzon driven back again. Scotland have gone low to stop the Italians trying to drive it with their feet initially, but can they come round the side? Yes, they can. All the players are to the left of this pile of bodies, though. There's nobody out to the right-hand side. However, they come this way. It's not quick. It's going to be power all the way from the Italians. A minute to play in the first half. Trailing by three. They're edging their way across. Can they recycle? The skipper goes for it once again. Scotland hold out. One more phase. Can they keep it up though? It's there for Palazzani. Gives it to Aguero. Free play for Italy. What do they want to do? They're going to stay with the power this time. It's a huge space on the right-hand side. Wingers in acres of space if they can pit it out. It's the kick pass. And the winger was offside. Sarto looking along the line. They had the free play. They had the opportunity. I'm afraid to say, that is bombed.
The ball going deep in the pocket. And there Tommaso Adam looking for Venditti on the wing. But the kick is overcooked. They just needed to keep that ball in play. Even though there is advantage, there we see Matias Aguero actually breaking off that ruck. Vanessa going against the grain at risk of getting a turnover because the defense is actually coming from that side. It needs to be a same way attack, build the momentum, put stress under the Scottish defenders.
So, final action of the first period. A penalty bang in front of the posts. This shouldn't be a problem. And it isn't. And after a pulsating, driving first 40 minutes, it's penalties all the way, three apiece at the interval. Italy 9, Scotland 9. And there we go. Tommaso Allan kicks long. Scotland will claim. And that's a fabulous handoff as well. That's 30 metres in a heartbeat as Ash takes the ball up to the 10-metre line. Strokosz does well to regather it, but then fires away a loose ball. And Scotland immediately lose those 15 metres. They have at least gathered it. For half a second, there was an overlap down Scotland's right-hand side if they wanted it. Hidalgo Klein, charge down! The opportunity is there, and it disappears in a heartbeat as well. Zani does brilliantly to block it, but he's not able to claim the ball.
Just see Zani there putting massive pressure on that left boot of Hidalgo Klein. I wouldn't be surprised if it was something that was said at half-time. He's making clearance kicks without any pressure on him at all. And there you see Alessandro Zani with the charge down and just so close to making that recovery.
Scotland will, I'm sure,
not be happy with that. We saw Jim Hamilton, if he's the guard, he needs to be 2 yards closer because there was a free run on the scrum half at Algo Klein.
He just needs to offer him that just extra bit of protection, and having someone two metres plus in the likes of Jim Hamilton doing that is ideal.
It's a human roundabout. It's a long way round him, and he's putting his bulk to good use in that scrummage. Scotland win the penalty, and we'll get a chance to clear as well.
Brilliant scrum here from Scotland, just piling on the pressure. Mike Cusack's angle there is ideal for a tight head. You need to be on a slight right angle to get back in at the hooker. He's done it legally. He's done it really well. Good scrum from Scotland.
Aguero had problems from the very start there, and you saw he was the first man to hit the turf. And from there, it was always going to be problems. Good right boot by Duncan Weir. Safely into the Italian half on the right-hand side. And now the line-out, which has gone pretty well for Scotland, will get an opportunity. Hamilton's calling for it at the back, but it's Richie Gray in the middle who gets it. Now that's good attacking ball for Matt Scott, straight down the centre. Hidalgo Klein gives it back to Ash. Good tackle, stops him in his steps, and Hidalgo Klein fumbles this time. It appears to be catching this evening, or not, as the case may be. Italy still have the ball. Now, do they have the opportunity? Always under pressure is the call, and so we'll go back for the scrummage.
What a tackle there from Gonzalo Garcia. Just see him coming in, shoulder on, driving Scottish player back in Adam Ash. It's what he does best. Gonzalo Garcia is fantastic at defence, and here we see Italy moving the ball. Same thing again, just lacking that little bit of precision for them to maintain the ball.
To be fair, you wouldn't necessarily want to see Valerio Bernardo as your left winger, would you? He does many good things, but I'm not necessarily suggesting that you wouldn't have him there in your first choice.
The ideal position for your tight forwards after a set piece is to actually work your way closer towards the ruck, and you don't really want tight forwards sitting on that edge, which is basically your outside your second post. Yeah, we see my head clash between the two front rowers. They've just met behind that tackle with on Matias Aguero, and two big heavyweights coming into contact there.
Well, it's going to be running repairs. So that means, at least for a few minutes, Alistair Dickinson will be joining the fray. ...31-year-old Edinburgh prop, 45th international cap, made his debut against New Zealand in 2007. Certainly got the experience to deal with this situation. Right, let's see if we can get this one completed. That ball's just sitting there waiting for one side to be dominant and push over it, but it's not going to happen.
When the scrum's under that much pressure, it's impossible to actually lift your foot to hook the ball. Matias Aguero was actually having a word with JP Doyle earlier on, mentioning that he can't actually get a long bind because of the way Mike Cusack was binding on him.
It's interesting, the International Rugby Board did put out a clarification and say they wanted the ball put down the middle and they wanted it hooked. We've not seen many scrums this evening where the ball's been hooked, but from what you're saying, it's actually very difficult if you are a hooker to be able to do that.
There's two things that'll happen once you try and hook the ball under pressure. One, you lift your foot, your pelvis rises, and the whole height of the scrum actually rises. It allows the opportunity for the opposition to get underneath you, assert that pressure, and the scrum will just repel backwards and you lose the ball.
So essentially, we've got ourselves a pushing contest. Palazzani puts the ball in, goes straight to deck, and JP Doyle gives the penalty in favour of the home side. And unless I'm very much mistaken, I don't think the scrums are going to be helped, because I think we've got some rain now falling in Turin as well.
I think it's already loose underfoot as it is, and then to add that to it, it just becomes a bit of an interpretation contest for JP Doyle. But the penalty there going towards Italy, and Matheus Aguirre actually reacting well to the ref's request.
Well, Alistair Dickinson is going to be staying on for Scotland, so he is going to be with us for the remaining 35 minutes of this game. Italy have themselves a line-out. Halfway inside Scotland half. Can they win it cleanly? A little bit of rain's probably not going to help. They've at least won it. It's a knock-on at the front of the line-out by Scotland, so they have a free play for the time being. But again, it's under pressure. Fumbled, turned over, but it was a free play, and as a result we'll come back for another scrummage. Not a great deal of flow at the moment, Carlo.
The key word there from JP Doyle, under pressure. It's constantly what Italy's attack is. Alessandro Zani just taking his eye off the ball before he's actually caught it, and it's slow ball. It allows Scotland to rappel off the line and actually put huge tackles in.
The engagement, attitude engagement is good, but after that, we've got to hang in there. If you leave that ball in the scrum and you're unwilling to play it, if you guys give away penalties, you go off the pitch. Okay? It's up to you whether you use it or not, but if you give away penalties, I'll get rid of guys.
Very interesting what JP Doyle, you can tell he's getting frustrated. And of course, when you get changes in the front row, that doesn't help either. And here we see Willem Nel is going to join the action for Scotland, the tight head prop. So Mike Cusack leaves the field. Willem now comes on for his international debut. South African-born, qualified through residency this year. The man from Edinburgh. Is that going to help or hinder the scrummages? And Italy are about to make a change as well. Michele Rizzo will be with us soon. The prop who plays with the Leicester Tigers in England. He's not going to be on before this scrummage, though.
Crouch. Five. Six.
It's stationary. And the Scots have got a good shove on that. He's popped out the side. And we play on as John Hardy takes the ball. Good work by the open side. Scotland through Duncan Weir see huge space down the field. Mazin Boath, time to collect, decide what he wants to do. And what he wants to do is thump it down the right-hand side. Scotland decide to put some flow into the game, take it short. Tonks hoists it. There's nobody there for Italy. And it's going to bounce up, and what an opportunity that was. There was an exclusion zone in the Italian half there. What happened with their defence? Rory Hughes came screaming through without a shirt anywhere near him. And if he'd taken that, he was on to the races, try time.
Andrea Muzzi, after making that clearance kick, actually went into midfield, and the opposition winger, Rory Hughes, had an absolute clear run in there if he just had fielded that ball.
What an opportunity from a situation that should have been. Aguero's left us. Rizzo is on for Italy in the front row. And you can hear JP Doyle saying, don't collapse it. And Jim Hamilton got his arms around the bear hug and then just let his weight do the rest, really.
The first part was absolutely spot on. He fought his way through the middle of the mall, and all he had to do then was just keep it up, and it would have been a turnover. JP Doyle was very precise in what he said. Keep it up, don't collapse it.
So another opportunity in this game goes abank. I still can't believe how much space there was in the Italian half of the field there. There's going to be slightly less space in the field now, though, as the cheers go up. for Leonardo Gherardini and Martin Castrogiovanni. Two of the old war horses. They've been around international rugby almost since time began. And they will put their stamp on this game. Of that, I think we can be fairly sure, Carlo.
Without a doubt. We said they were going to be coming on and using that bench at around the 50-55 minute mark. They need to make a real impact now. Scotland have made the right changes at the right time. Italy then need to bounce back.
Well, they've done the first bit. Gherardini gets the throw, collects the loose ball and takes it into contact. Here comes the power. The skipper takes it on, Helder Huis. Scotland really are fighting hard at breakdown time. Gherardini acts as scrum half, but then gets enveloped by three dark blue shirts. Castrogiovanni for a turn. Good spin, presents cleanly. Opportunity down the left or not. Benvenuti fighting really hard to make sure that that ball does come back. Castrogiovanni on the burst. 50 minutes played, and you sense that the home crowd are starting to feel that maybe something is on here with this game in the balance. 9 points apiece. Again, it's slowed down. Gherardini takes it into contact. There are six men out to the right-hand side for Italy if they can use them at the moment. It's through the middle, though, through Castrogiovanni. Good tackle by Strokos. Slows it down for a moment. Rizzo takes it on. And now Tommaso Allan. To Mazzi. This time it's worked well. Zani takes it on. Gherardini beats the first man. Richie Gray's in there to slow him down sufficiently. For the time being anyway. Here comes the power. They're over the line. Can they get it down? And JP Doyle isn't sure.
The two replacements off the bench, Leonardo Gherardini and Castrogiovanni, using all of their power, direct running down route one, spinning, explosive with their ball carries, and potentially he's got himself over the line.
Well, my apologies, JP Doyle sounded initially as if he wasn't sure, but he's giving a strum straight away. So it's going to be a scrum to Italy, and they're about to make another change as another of those war horses is going to be entering the field of play, as Marco Bortolami will be joining us for Valerio Bonabo.
Just see Castro twirling and spinning out of the contact there, but it looks like that man Alistair Dickinson actually underneath that ball stopping that try.
Well, we're going to have the scrum before Bortolami joins us for his 112th cap, but not before we get another change, as Ross Ford is going to come in at hooker for Stuart McAnally. So the debutant's night is over, and in fact, as there's the pause in play, Italy decide Bortolami will join us. So we continue the replacements up front. All the experience that was on that Italian bench looks like it's starting to come into play. Big scrummage, this one. Italy are almost moving and they're able to get the drive, but straight away it goes to ground again. And you can see the divots coming up. JP Doyle's not apportioning any blame there. Imagine the weight coming through of 16 players, and you can see instantly the studs just rip up the turf.
If you don't have any purchase on your feet, it's one of the fundamentals of getting your scrum right. Getting your feet stuck into the ground, dropping your knees low to the scrum, and surging your pelvis forward, and that gives you your go forward, that gives you your stability, and allows everybody to push in cohesion.
Castro Giovanni really is remarkable. 33 years of age, now 2-1, 111 cap, 87 of them starts. He really has done an incredible job. And he's weighed in with 12 tries as well. This time, though, it's about pushing. But the two sides were doing it a little bit too early.
Being a right-hand lock, pushing behind the likes of someone like Castro Giovanni, it just makes your day that much easier. Because he does so much work in the scrum, you give him the initial hit, give him a bit of support after that, and he pretty much does the rest on his own. He's fantastic to scrum around. He's very mobile, very explosive, and a very good leader, and contributes well to the team tactics.
Well, if Italy can get a good nudge on here and just rotate it ever so slightly to their left, this scrummage is 5 metres out, but 15 in from the left-hand touchline. That's a nice little angle if you can take the back row out of play of Scotland. Other than that, they can sweep it wide. Of course, we need the ball to come back first. The front rows are down, but I think JP Doyle's going to, I was about to say, let this one go because it might be available. But as soon as it wasn't quickly, he didn't have a great deal of choice there.
I think JP Doyle's nearly at his wits end with the scrums this evening.
We've got to get our height up. The ground is terrible. We've got to get our height up, OK? Height up. Height. With the ground, height up. Height up. No. You, height up. Height up. Both of you
are higher. I'll try and keep it up if you want, sir, but he's pulling me down. There's not a lot I can do. Castro Giovanni, he'd make a wonderful actor if he wasn't a rugby player.
Front row is there for it, please.
Fabulous expressions.
No. Wait for the ball. Crouch! Fine. Set.
That one is secure. Italy are getting into driving position, but Scotland have gone down, so it depends what JP Doyle wants to do here. They're going to let Italy play. They're going to pick it up, close range. There's a bit of a scuffle going on as the players break up from the scrummage. But all that's happening while Italy are playing on. Not anymore, though, because as you hear, there's an intervention for foul play. And we will go to Graham Hughes for the first time this evening, television match official.
We've got a blue screen up here, Graham.
So Hidalgo Klein's being held back, which is why he's swinging away, trying to get himself out of the problem.
No, I've got blue screen. If you're happy it's just a penalty head roll, I'll crack on.
Did he say head roll? I think he did.
There's no screen here, I'm just getting a blue screen, 55-17 on it. Number, please, Graham.
So JP Doyle is looking at a screen which isn't showing him a replay, so he's going to have to take advice from Graham Hughes. As we get more changes.
Same as the first half against year three.
Scotland have made a change as Hamish Watson comes on, and he's going to replace the very impressive John Hardy.
Same as the first half against the Scotland tight head roll.
So the penalty goes against Italy for holding the player back. And Francesco Minto is the man who gives it away. And again, another great position, Carlo, that Italy have got themselves into, but not been able to make anything of it.
It's very promising. Having an attacking scrum in an opposition 22 is pure gold from a strike move point of view. And just to let it dissipate into something that was not necessary at all is quite disheartening. But in the back shot, we actually didn't see John Hardy actually leaving the field. He's been absolutely fantastic this evening. He's tackled his heart out. He's been an absolute menace at the breakdown. He's played and contributed everything that he possibly can this evening.
So he's been an international player for 55 minutes. And from what you've seen, you think he might have done enough to give Vern Cotter something to think about?
He's been one of the outstanding players on the field this evening, and I think he would stake a claim to be in that position.
So clean line out for Scotland. And they're just walking forward. Hidalgo Klein will hoist it. And Lamont will go up and try and contest. It's going to bounce around. And now there might be an opportunity for Scotland if they can get it wide quickly. And Hughes on the far side is a quick finisher. Tonks will take it on. 10 metres outside of the 22. It will come back. Jim Hamilton is loitering on the right wing for Scotland at the moment if they want to go for the kick pass. They're going to go back left-hand side, though. And this is the option as Tonks takes it, gives it, gets it back to Scott. Hughes takes it further forward. And up to the 22. Now, what have Scotland got? Strike runners. It's a huge overlap to the right-hand side if they want to use it. Oh, the first pass goes to ground. Lamont will take it on, but he's fighting all the way to try and get the momentum back. Precision in attack is something we have not really seen this evening, it has to be said in Turin. As another penalty is given away, the player joining the pile of bodies, but not from the rearmost feet. And that's a simple one for JP Doyle.
Leonardo Sato did well to make that initial tackle there, and he's gone in to make the counter ruck, but then loses his feet on the other side. And JP Doyle, he's got no option there but to give that penalty as the infringement happened right in front of him.
So 17 minutes into the second half, we're going to get our first opportunity at points. Duncan Weir will get the shot at goal. He's been successful 3 out of 3. It's 4 yards in from the right-hand touchline. To re-establish Scotland's lead. It's clean contact, it's tight to the right-hand post, and it is just wide of the right-hand post. Duncan Weir misses for the first time. We have ourselves a tied ball game still as we approach the hour mark. So Hamish Watson is on permanently. It's not a temporary replacement. He will be with us for the last 22, 23 minutes of this game. And he's going to be getting round his number 8, Adam Ash. Good strong work from him. Takes it into the contact. Italy try and slow it down, as you can see. Hidalgo Klein digs it out. Weir will swing it via Scott. Vernon takes it on. That's a poor pass though, and again all the momentum's gone. Hamilton will there, almost in a sweeper role, picking it up. He was looking for the man to come around to offload too, but he wasn't able to, as Italy got around, and that's going to be kicked straight out of play on the full. And it just looks like the pressure is starting to get to Scotland, where in the first half they were making the right decisions and the 50-50s were going their way. Scotland under pressure now, just starting to make a couple of little mistakes.
What they're actually trying to do is actually move the ball through 10's hands a lot more. Their strike runners are running off 10 and outside on his shoulder, whereas Italy are using a completely different style of play, running off 9, being really close in all their contacts. And I think the idea to play an expansive game plan is something that you really need to look at, especially going into World Cup. But the execution of it, it means you need to have absolutely lightning quick ball at the ruck to make that really effective. And as soon as you throw a pass and everybody's standing in a flat line, you then concede potentially 20 metres. Unfortunate miss there from Duncan Weir. He's been really good this evening. He's communicated well. His distribution's been outstanding. And just one little error, but I think he should be proud of his performance this evening.
Italy will make another change very shortly. Mauro Bergamasco will be with us, and he's watching this lineout. Italy come forward well. Benvenuti, Castro Giovanni. Scotland doing well to delay proceedings, but not legally. That's a forward pass, surely. No, JP Doyle will allow that one to go for the time being. No, he does give the forward pass. and we'll go back for the penalty. So Mauro Bergamasco is stripped off and ready to join us for cap number 103. And he replaces Alessandro Zanni. Another change for Scotland. Henry Purgos will be with us as he replaces Sam Hidalgo Klein. But all of this while Tommaso Allan is lining up this penalty to give Italy the lead for the first time in the game. And he's having to battle the PA announcer. They didn't seem to bother him. Good clean strike. And Italy have the lead for the first time in the game. 100% from the kicking team. And we've got ourselves. Well, it might not be the greatest game in the world, but it's tense and it looks like we're going to have a grandstand finish, Carlo.
I think so too. It's very important now that Italy recover this kickoff and make their way back down into the Scotland half.
Scotland make another change, as you see, Damien Hoyland, the Edinburgh winger, joining us, replacing Rory Hughes, the Glasgow winger, both of them debutants, both of them former sevens players for Scotland. He goes on to the far side, as the kickoff is taken near side, Italy do claim. Rizzo fights hard. To Allan, who clears, but only 10 metres or so outside of the 22, Scotland will have a chance to put some pressure on. Imagine Scotland are somewhat surprised they find themselves behind in this game.
I think they would. They've had the ascendancy, they've had all of the field advantage. What they didn't have, though, is just that precise accuracy at the right moment. One thing that has functioned really well, though, for Scotland is their line-out, and it's a great attacking position now. And we see both their wingers, Sean Lamont, is looking inside 10.
Well, I was about to say, and I'm glad I didn't say it, Ross Ford is an excellent line-out man. But the first one is not straight.
Just as I say, the Scotland line-out has functioned really well.
Get your attitudes right.
It's just a knock on there, actually, from caused by Quinton Geldenhuis, knocking the catcher's hand, and the ball's actually gone to ground and deemed a knock on by JP Doyle. So position then reverts back to Italy.
In that case, I refer you to my previous comment. Ross Ford is normally very good in the lineups. Now he's in a scrum. Scotland almost got the nudge on slightly too early then. JP Doyle made a slight move for his whistle, but the ball does come out, so let us play while we have the opportunity. Hacked down the field. Scotland through Tonks. And that left boot of his will keep it in play, but put it 60 yards down the field. Which way do they want to go, left or right? Italy go down the right-hand side, and this is heading and arrowing for the corner flag. Fabulous kick. Fabulous, fabulous kick. Tommaso Allan puts his team in position number one.
Tommaso Allan absolutely on the money. You couldn't have asked for a better kick into the corner. Nothing there that Damien Hoyland could actually do, but excellent exit kick line out here from Scotland.
Well, 5 metres out, of course, the defence has to be 10 metres back, so if you can go long, you have the opportunity, because your players are 5 metres closer, and that's what Scotland did, and they were able to exit, but they've only kicked it as far as Mazzy. Now, here we go, is this the opportunity that they need? Sarto and Venditti have gone looking for work. But they've very rarely seen it in space. That's really well caught. Fighting hard for every single space. Again, Scotland competes so hard at the rucks. Italy are probably having to commit more men than they would want to actually secure the ball. And again, it's hard yards. One and two at a time. Lovely little kick this time into the space. Which way is the ball going to bounce? Well, it Tonks overruns it. Italy piling forward. Can they claim it back? No, they can't. And they infringe as well to make it worse.
Very good variation there in Italy's attack, but very well fielded by Scotland, who had loads of numbers in that area to field that ball. An infringement coming in from Italy, actually pushing over the ruck, off their feet, and giving away the penalty.
So there, Luke McLean joining us. He replaces Tommaso Benvenuti. Luke McLean hasn't played a club game since the 30th of November with Sale Sharks. So I imagine he is absolutely itching to get out there. Benvenuti's had a decent evening. Back into Italian reckoning. And McLean straight away called into action, fields the ball. And Italy will try and get momentum. Scotland aren't able to bring that down at the first attempt. They can at the second, and they've turned it over as well. Opportunities down the right-hand side. Vernon does well. But they didn't have enough players around that. And as a result, Italy can just kick it safely into touch.
Scotland doing well, actually dancing with the touchline here. But once this tackle's made and the ball's placed, you see the right foot of Leonardo Sarto actually kicking that ball into touch. But Richie Vernon's done well to keep a big tight head on his back.
Another change for Scotland. Peter Horne is on in place of Richie Vernon and goes into the midfield. And he'll get an opportunity to get some attacking intent into this situation. As you see, straight up to the edge of the 22. Purgos quickly away from the base of the ruck. Scotland are flooding it left. Alistair Strokos is out in the right wing position, a yard in from the touchline. If they want to do the kick pass across and can execute this time, but they're not going to be able to from that because Italy have slowed it right down. Good recycling. Scott takes it on. Purgos fires it, and Greg Tonks knows what he's trying to do. It's programmed to be an inside ball, but he can't get hold of it, loses it. It's knocked on, and McLean fires it down the centre of the pitch. Plenty of time and space for Sean Lamont. Does he want to try and run? No, he doesn't. He puts it down the field. Well collected by Palazzani. Venice has been front and centre for the Italians this evening. He's carried an awful lot of ball. Now Rizzo, but loses it in the contact. I think contact drills are going to be heavily on the Italian game plan during the training week that's coming up before the return game against Scotland. And Scotland have the chance themselves. It's got to come back to the right-hand side. All the players are this way. Castro Giovanni, first man in on the tackle. Tonk slots in the standoff position. Buys his team some time. Richie Gray popping up in the right-hand channel. And where we were saying in the first half that it was the Scottish defence that were coming in and making the tackles, it's the Italians now, and Venisa makes another one, drives his man backwards. gets a mouthful of turf. But there's still a chance here. And here comes Scotland again through Horn. He's beaten one, beaten two. The covering tackle comes in. McLean gets there. McLean in there. Great effort. Gets back. And they've turned the ball over as well, have they? Yes, they have. Diffused the situation.
Use it.
Look, for all the world that Peter Horn was going to have a run in. But Italy turn it over and get it safely out of play.
What a break here from Scotland, and Peter Horn showing great pace. But look at Luke McLean in jersey number 23 making that telling tackle. It's the offloads in contact that put attacking runners into space. And just look at him. He's balanced. He's controlled. It's that massive tackle from the blind side from Luke McCain that just coughs the ball up into contact.
The two men making the tackle. The first going low allows McLean to come in, go that bit higher around the chest, and attack the ball. And that's what dislodges it. 8.5 minutes, just a bit over to play. Italy leads Scotland by 12-9.
Give yourself room.
Scotland
yourself
have room. The Italy edge have over Italy. Scotland, 15 room. Wins to 8. But Italy did win the last meeting of the two sides in the Six Nations in Edinburgh. They've won 2 of the last 17 matches against Scotland.
Over.
Sorry, 2 of the last 7 against what? Scotland, and 2 of their last 17.
Use it now.
Can they see this one through? Scotland can go either way. They come to the right-hand side. Garcia's up quickly, makes the tackle. Scotland fighting hard. Strokos clearing the Italian players out the way so Purgos can get the ball. Jim Hamilton, the number 5 for Scotland, has to get his body in there and drive it clear. But they're penalised, the Italians. And Purgos will see the opportunity. Was he tackled early? JP Doyle says play on the referee. Now Richie Gray finds himself in the centres and will pop the ball out to the left-hand side to Horn. Now, is this the opportunity as they go over the 22 again? Scotland, can they get it quick? Italy have a man down in the backfield. They're defending with 14. Again, another sloppy pass, though. Tonks makes amends. Picks it up. Scott is loitering wide on the right-hand side. This 4-on-4 down this right-hand side. Tonks this time gets the flip pass away to Scott. Hamilton missed out this time. As Scotland go along the back, tackle comes in, it's knocked on. Scotland will have advantage. They can play the ball and will do so. Hamish Watson, the man, tidying it up. And again, loose ball from Scotland. Sean Lamont, lovely hands. Now here's the chance. Scott, he's got a 2-on-1. All he's got to do is get the ball inside. And he does. And Perlos will go in for the try. Probably the highest moment of quality in the 73 minutes that we've seen. And Scotland exploit it perfectly. They go back into the lead as Purgos goes over.
Fantastic end to a lung-busting multiple-phase play. 2 turnovers and finished by that man, Henry Purgos. We see the tackle from Bortolami getting missed there, but as he goes down the touchline, it's a perfect 2-on-1. The ball gets into Henry Purgos' hands and he's over. The whitewash. Luke McLean can't actually get to this one.
It looks so easy to execute that. I assure you, it's not. It's about the timing to commit the defender and then the man supporting to make the line, to make the right angle. And Purgos did just that.
And it's that pass actually executed at pace that needs to be precise. The depth needs to be held by the attacking runner. And Henry Purgos did everything right there. And there were players scattered all over the field once that try has been scored.
This to give Scotland a 4-point lead. Got it. We're with the conversion. And with 5 minutes to play, Scotland have a 4-point lead. And Italy are going to make some more changes. It's a new halfback pairing. Marcelo Violi and Carlo Canna is actually going to come on. Not at halfback, it's Gonzalo Garcia. Scotland are going to play territory, you would imagine, for the last 4 minutes or so. Just a little bit too deep. That kick will allow Italy to make the clearance. That's a big few minutes for Marcelo Violi, Carlo.
He's a young guy that's come on for his first cap. And to be on the bench, to come on, there's still 4 minutes left. And the game that's this close, he needs to perform. There's not much that he can actually do, but everything that he does do in this short space of time needs to be absolutely spot on.
Samuel Venisa, the number 8 for Italy, has been awarded the man of the match. He has done an awful lot of work, taking off kickoffs and running them back. But at the moment, he's on the losing side, unless Scotland are just inside their own half. 3 minutes to play. Can they? Have they got the game management to see this through? Hoisted by Purgos, very close to the touchline, over the touchline. Well, that's the game management we're just talking about.
Going back to Samuele Venisa, actually being called the man of the match, he's been fantastic this evening. He's carried the ball extremely hard, he's been direct. He's carried the ball into those really close, hard contacts. He's fielded his kickoffs really well, and he's played both the number 8 and substituted really in the number 6 role. And the man of the match directly needs to be to, justly actually should need to be go to Samuele Venisa.
Only his 6th cap, but he looks a man at home at this level.
He's been really comfortable. In the Six Nations, he's carried ball really well. He's actually made huge breaks against that last game against Wales. And he's been really involved in the team. He's got himself into better physical condition. He can actually handle 18 minutes now at Tesh level.
So we're getting towards last chance saloon, and that's not going to help Italy's cause. Scotland pick it up through Watson, and now they drive forward. Good line by Scott, takes the ball, just holds on to it and then loses it as he hits the deck. One knock on, then a second. Italy will have the ball with 2 minutes to play, but 70 metres away from where they need to be.
There we see Andrea Mazzeschi flying into that tackle there, but just the imprecision between Marco Bortolami and Leonardo Ghiraldini. Marco trying to go for the offload. He needs to just secure that ball. It's loose. Dive on it. Contain the possession and then build your exit strategy from there.
The seconds tick by for Italy. They need this scrum to stay up. And referee JP Doyle has decided that Scotland went early.
Castro, okay, next time I get rid of you.
Martin Castro Giovanni reacts. That's why JP Doyle has a word. But what that has done is taken another 20 seconds off of the clock. If that was a tactic by Scotland, it worked quite nicely. There's a minute to play.
Italy electing there not to actually kick for touch, but to go for another scrum. And mumbled through the bearded face of Castro Giovanni to JP Doyle was, "I want to play the scrum, sir," so it's something that he's looking to do.
His former colleague at the Leicester Tigers, Ben Youngs, the England scrum half, once told me he's really a big teddy bear. I never actually had the bravery to put that to him. Well, he's going to get a chance to have another scrummage.
Hold your space. Get off
as the time ticks on. Scotland in the lead. Italy 12, Scotland 16.
I said before the game, the ball will not come in until it's steady. Crouch! Five! Six!
Italy need this ball in and out quickly. Oh, and then they've wasted the opportunity.
Clapped on this side.
The scrum stability was there, but the ball just wasn't coming in. Scotland did really well there to hold their patience, keep the pressure on. The signal was given to the scrum half to put it in, but the ball didn't come in. Scotland have exerted a huge amount of pressure on that scrum.
Castrogiovanni, sorry, is the man penalised. Duncan Weir knows that with time up, all he has to do is put it off the field of play. And Scotland have their first win of the summer. They have been victorious in Turin. Italy 12, Scotland 14.